and welcome to the Literary Lutheran Reads a Book of Concord. Today we are continuing to go through Article 3 of the Small Called Articles on Repentance. But all this too did nothing. Even though the Pope taught people to depend on and trust these indulgences for salvation, he made the matter uncertain again. In his bulls he declares that whoever wants to share in the indulgences or a golden year has to be contrite and have confessed and pay money. We have already seen how, with the papacy, contrition and confession are uncertain and hypocritical. Besides, no one knew what soul was in purgatory. If some souls were in purgatory, no one knew who had properly repented and confessed. So the Pope took the precious money, comforting people with his power and indulgence, but then he directed them again to their uncertain works. Now some did not believe themselves guilty of actual sins in thought, word, and deeds. I, and people like me in monasteries and religious communities, wanted to be monks and priests. We fought against evil thoughts by doing such things as fasting, staying awake, praying, saying Mass, wearing coarse garments, and sleeping on hard beds. In total sincerity and with great effort, we wanted to be holy. Yet the hereditary inborn evil sometimes came out in sleep, as happens. St. Augustine and St. Jerome, among others, also confess this. Still, each one held the other in high esteem. According to our teaching, some monks were regarded as holy without sin and full of good works. Also, since we had more good works than we needed to get to heaven, we could communicate and sell our good works to others. This is actually true. Seals, letters, and examples are at hand to prove that this happened. These holy ones did not need repentance. What would they repent of since they had not indulged their wicked thoughts? What would they confess about words they never said? What should they render satisfaction for, since they were so guiltless that they could even sell their extra righteousness to poor sinners? In the time of Christ, the Pharisees and scribes were these kinds of saints. See Matthew chapter 23. But here comes the fiery angel of St. John, Revelation 10, the true preacher of repentance. With one bolt of lightning, he hurls together both those selling and those buying works. He says, repent, Matthew chapter 3, verse 2. Now, one group imagines why we have repented. The other says, we need no repentance. John says, repent, both of you, you false penitents and false saints. Both of you need the forgiveness of sins. Neither of you know what sin really is, much less your duty to repent of it and shun it. For no one of you is good. You are full of unbelief, stupidity, and ignorance of God and God's will. But he is present here, of whose fullness we have all received grace upon grace. John chapter 1, verse 16. Without him, no one can be righteous before God. Therefore, if you want to repent, repent rightly. Your works of penance will accomplish nothing. As for you hypocrites, who do not need repentance, you serpent brood, who has assured you that you will escape the wrath to come and other judgments? Matthew chapter 3, verse 7 and Luke chapter 3, verse 7. In the same way, Paul also preaches, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside, together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Romans chapter 3, verses 10 to 12. And God now commands all people everywhere to repent. Acts chapter 17, verse 30. All people, he says. No one is an exception who is a human being. This repentance teaches us to discern sin. We are completely lost. There is nothing good in us from head to foot, and we must become absolutely new and different people. Such repentance is not partial and beggarly, like that which does penance for actual sins, nor like that is it uncertain. For it does not debate what is or is not sin. Rather, it hurls everything together and says, everything in us is nothing but sin. There is nothing in us that is not sin and guilt. Romans chapter 7, verse 18. What is the use of always investigating, dividing, or distinguishing? This contrition is certain. For we cannot think of any good thing to pray for sin. There is nothing left. There is only a sure despairing about all that we are, think, speak, do, and so on. Confession, too, cannot be false, uncertain, or fragmentary. A person who confesses that everything in him is nothing but sin, includes all sins, excludes none, forgets none. Neither can the satisfaction be uncertain, because it is not our uncertain sinful work. Rather, it is the suffering and blood of the innocent Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. John chapter 1, verse 29. This is the repentance John the Baptist preaches. Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. And afterward, Christ does this in the Gospel. Mark chapter 1, verse 15, and so do we. By this preaching of repentance, we dash to the ground the Pope and everything built upon our good works. For all of that is built upon a rotten and vain foundation, which is called a good work or a law. And yet this foundation has no good works, but only wicked works. No one keeps the law, as Christ says, but all transgress it. John chapter 7, verse 19. Therefore, the building that is raised upon that rotten foundation is nothing but falsehood and hypocrisy, even where it seems most holy and beautiful. In Christians, this repentance continues until death. For through one's entire life, repentance contends with the sin remaining in the flesh. Paul testifies that he wars with the law in his members, Romans chapter 7, verses 14 through 25, not by his own powers, but by the gift of the Holy Spirit that follows the forgiveness of sins, Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 17. This gift daily cleanses and sweeps out the remaining sins and works to make a person truly pure and holy. The Pope, the theologians, and the church lawyers, and the rest know nothing about this, but it is a doctrine from heaven revealed through the gospel, and the godless saints must call it heresy. This has been the Literary Lutheran Reads the Book of Concord, and I wish you a blessed day.